Lambeau Field, Fenway Park, the Rose Bowl, the athletic venues that stand as great monuments and landmarks in our sports landscape. This hour on Yahoo Sports Radio, we take you from coast to coast to the most famous stadiums and arenas in all of sports. Stadiums USA Radio.
In-depth conversation focusing on the popular venues across the sports globe, from the pros to the minor leagues to college.
The latest news in stadium design, renovations, and stadium connections to their communities. Your host, Bill Hazen, talks with athletes, coaches, authors, and newsmakers who share their experiences and connections to the most storied structures and stadiums in all of sports.
The conversation is now.
Broadcasting from Stadiums USA headquarters in Chicago, here's the man who was behind the mic detailing Michael Jordan's entry into the NBA. And now, he is your official stadium guy with your ticket to the latest stadium news and information. Here he is, Bill Hazen.
It's hard to believe it, but this year will mark the 50th anniversary of the New Orleans Saints, and they have a fascinating stadium story, and it covers some ground that we have not covered on this program before. We're going to call in Saints historian William Taylor, who has a genuine love for the franchise and for years has collected material, covered the team, and built an amazing history of this team and the rich tradition of New Orleans Saints football. William, we welcome you to the program. We cover the stadium's beat, so we're certainly interested in Tulane Stadium and, of course, the Mercedes-Benz Superdome where the team currently plays. Let's dig into the Tulane Stadium first, a very famous stadium to many. Take us inside that place and your memories of it.
Oh, sure. Well, Tulane Stadium was first constructed and erected back in October of 1926. Tulane University had used two other pieces of property for football fields prior to that. And in 1925, their football team went 9-0-1, and from that incredible success they had, in just 1 week, the university raised enough money to build a concrete reinforced stadium in time leading into their Auburn game of October 1926. Well, from there, a gentleman by the name of Fred Digby, who wrote for the New Orleans Item newspaper, thought that this new stadium would be a perfect place for an annual postseason college bowl game. Mm-hmm. And it was Mr. Digby that coined the term the Sugar Bowl. And about another 8 years later, it would become reality, and the stadium would host the first Sugar Bowl on January 1 of 35. Between 35 and the late 1950s, as the popularity of the Sugar Bowl increased, the stadium was able to get more funding to further expand itself until it got to well over 83,000 capacity.
A lot of people may not realize, but at its maximum configuration, its last configuration, Tulane Stadium was one of the largest stadiums in America. It topped off at 81,000. It was a huge physical plant. Can you speak to that?
Oh, yes. At one point, you're correct. It was the largest steel-structured stadium in the world. Tulane Stadium, like a lot of stadiums in its time, had a great mystique. A lot of people, when they went to either a Tulane home game or a Saints game, it was almost like an extension of their own home, because just like a large part of old New Orleans, it had this great, almost antique-type relationship with the fans. And that another thing that also made Tulane Stadium so beloved by the fans, and I know this is going to sound a little awkward, is the sound. The way that steel-structured stadium, based on its final expansion, it created the strangest echo when people would slam their feet to the ground, to the base of the stadium. And it was almost like it would echo. It was just a strange reverberation that echoes to this day in the minds of the fans who were able to go to their games in that beloved stadium for decades. So it really, like I said, it had a great ambiance for the fans of New Orleans, especially through both sound and sight, and it's something that, you know, will never, ever be replaced.
It is not a coincidence that two of the great early dome stadiums in the country both happen to be in the Southwest. That's not by accident. If you've experienced the weather, particularly during the summer, it can get so humid there. That was why the Houston Astrodome was built. And, of course, the Mammoth Superdome, which followed it on an even larger scale, provided the same benefits for people in Louisiana and nearby Mississippi. Take us through the process of how this dome stadium got built.
That same gentleman I mentioned earlier, Dave Dixon, who led the charge to get the Saints to New Orleans, also led the charge for a new stadium. Now, this was in 1965 that he first proposed an indoor stadium that he called the Superdome. Now, 3 years earlier, in 1962, Mr. Bill Keith, who was the executive sports editor of the Times-Picayune newspaper, was the first member of the media to publicly support a new stadium for the pro team they would get one day. Ironically, 1 week after the franchise was awarded to New Orleans, statewide voters approved the constitutional amendment that allowed for the building of the Superdome, of course, November 8, 1966. The only problem was there was a handful of businessmen and elected officials who thought the Superdome was going to be the greatest waste of money in Louisiana history. And as a result, they filed lawsuits that literally stopped the building of the Superdome for 4.5 years. So as a result, until the last lawsuit was thrown out of court, they couldn't start building it until June of 1971. There were some flaws in the way of trying to build it. Weather, of course, since it rained so much in the spring and summer down here, that caused a lot of delays. But a funny story many people aren't aware of, another thing that delayed the completion of the Superdome, and I am not joking when I say this, when the state legislature put together the original budget for the building, they forgot to allocate money for the seat. Because when you count that along with the money the state had to pay to fight the lawsuits, that's why the final price of that building went up to $162 million. The original projection in 1967 was 46.7.
We all know that one of the primary drivers of the economy in New Orleans is people who visit, tourism. It turns out that the Superdome has been such a magnet for major events. Why has it been so effective in this way?
New Orleans is a very historic city throughout the world, and I think it has a great attraction because of that. In a sense, because it's a great combination of French, Spanish, and English heritage, and that no matter where you go in the city, you're always going to find something different, whether it's architecture or cooking, that really draws millions and millions. But at the same time, the placement of where the Superdome is was also very key, because the vast majority of the large and small hotels in New Orleans are literally within walking distance of the building. So when people come down to visit for that great building, whether it's a sporting event or other event held in there, many times after someone gets dropped off at their hotel from the airport, they don't have to necessarily worry about renting a car. They can literally just walk to wherever they need to go and, not have to worry about using the rental car. So what I call the tightness of that building next to all the surrounding hotels makes it very easily accessible to all coming in, and that's why so much of the national media love it when those Super Bowls are played in that grand old building.
Boy, you are right about that. New Orleans has so much to offer. I saw the Superdome pre-Katrina in its original setup, and of course it was Mammoth. It was rebuilt to a degree inside after Katrina, and of course the roof had to be totally redone. A number of things actually were totally redone. Can you talk about the dome pre-Katrina and post-Katrina?
Well, I guess the best way to summarize would be this. Pre-Katrina, the Superdome actually had several small evolutions between its original completion date of 1975 and through 2005. For example, if you first went there in the 70s into the 80s, you would remember right above the 50-yard line, it had several screens up there so fans could see replays somewhat easy. Mm-hmm. And ironically, there was a game in the January 76 Pro Bowl, you might remember, Ray Guy actually hit a punt so high it hit those screens. Well, and then by the time we got to the late 80s, those screens were taken down and were put behind the end zones, and with much better clarity for the fans to look at as well. Now, when you got into post-Katrina, that in literally just a period of about 13 months, that building almost went into light years ahead of what it was before. Electronic scoreboards with a lot of computer technology came in place, not just behind the end zones and up in the terrace section, but throughout all sections of the building. Oh, and also most importantly, after Katrina, the outdoor celebrations, as I call it, changed a lot. With the remodeling after Katrina, they have a Champion Square now, which I believe is in the southwest corner outside of the Superdome, which is totally reserved for fans to come out and enjoy free music concerts leading into All Saints home games.
William, thank you for visiting with us. This is a great story, and you happen to live near one of the truly iconic sports facilities in the world. So enjoy it. Have a wonderful season.
And you too. Everybody take care.
All right. William Taylor is the New Orleans Saints historian, and what a story. That's our program for this week. Bill Hazen inviting you to be back with us again next week. The Golf Show is next, and then a full day of sports coverage coming your way right here on Yahoo Sports Radio.